Jan de Vries. Applaus.
Thank you. All right. Thank you for your introduction. We started a little later, about 6 minutes, and moreover, I am between you and your lunch, right? Okay. I started as a developer, and nowadays I'm actually helping companies transform their conventional IT towards DevOps. That's the upper part. And the lower part is about helping companies to transform their products and their markets, actually. So actually, even earlier in the process than DevOps. My presentation is about anti-fragility. And anti-fragility and skin in the game is actually, it is everywhere. Also in this room, also in your company, it is everywhere. And it affects everything. But we do not realize that. And that's actually, I want to provide you with some navigation in the dark. To explain why some concepts work and others don't. I'm going to ask you a question, and I don't expect any hands, actually. Who is familiar with Hammurabi? Whoa, I like that. Yeah. Because Hammurabi, he lived about 3,800 years ago, but actually DevOps is actually built on Hammurabi 3,800 years ago. So how do we get from Mesopotamia 3,800 years ago to Riga 2018. I'm going to explain that. And Hammurabi actually he carved 282 laws, codes in stone. And we should zoom in to one code, and that is code 229. And it says, if a builder builds a house and the house collapses on and causes the death of the owner of the house, the builder shall be put to death. Do you see the link with DevOps? Right? Yeah. Yeah, the man was right, right? And there's a little evolution because 3,800 years ago, and in the meantime, there were a lot of religions and cultures, of course, starting. And they based actually their rules, their sweetened rules, on that code of Hammurabi, and it's like the golden rule, treat others the way you would like them to treat you, or the negative golden rule, which turns into the silver rule, says, do not treat others the way you would not like them to treat you. And then Warren Buffett, one of the richest people on this planet, he actually coined the term skin in the game. And it's a situation in which executives in a company invest their own money in the company they are running. So they are actually showing confidence in that particular company. It actually means they have skin in the game of the company. For Warren Buffett, it was only one quote, but this man, Nassim Nicholas Taleb, he actually based two books on it, and those books are Anti-Fragile and Skin in the Game, and he actually says, if you give an opinion and someone follows it, you are morally obligated to be yourself exposed to its consequences. You should have skin in the game. So don't take advice from somebody who is not involved in the game, because he wouldn't feel the negative consequences. So that's actually what he says. If you have no skin in the game, you should not be in the game. If you translate that to software, then you see this. If you develop software, and this is actually built on Taleb, but also built on Hammurabi. If you develop software and someone else will operate the software, you are morally obligated to be yourself exposed to its consequences. Or even better, of course, as a team, operate your own software. And the fact is that people in a dev silo, they don't have skin in the game in an ops silo, in ops. And people in an ops silo, they don't have a skin in the dev game. So you want them to have skin in the game in each other's game, so to say. So we already know the silo era is ending. So I would like to say, let's expedite that by creating more multidisciplinary teams. Who is familiar with Conway's Law? I think almost the same people that raised the hand when I talked about Hammurabi. Conway's law is also an important one, and this actually supports what I was just saying. He says, organizations which design systems are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures of these organizations. That means if you are building a system with four departments, you get a four-part system. Siloed organizations build siloed systems. So you should talk, you should think about your organization first. First optimize your organization, then optimize your system. Because if you start optimizing your systems, you will get at the boundaries of what is possible within your organization. The law is from 1968. And remember that Conway's law was and is seen as unbreakable. You cannot break Conway's law, but you can use Conway's law. So if you are optimizing your organization, your systems will be better. Another quote from the book is, you will never fully convince someone that he is wrong. Only reality can. And that is something that you see in Agile. But when you look at the definition of done of Agile only, it's of course too narrow. It's about build and test. The only reality check is in continuous deployment, because then we have a whole list of things we have to do before it is considered done. And the reality check makes it actually anti-fragile. So Agile alone is fragile, and continuous deployment is actually anti-fragile. And of course, Agile is better than waterfall, because then the definition of done is that at the end of a journey of 2 years, we discovered that we walked in the wrong direction, we built in the wrong direction. So Agile is a lot better, of course, but I like to call Agile alone. Agile SEC is actually fragile. Now, let me prove that continuous deployment is actually anti-fragile. The book Anti-Fragile is full of this kind of simple graphs. A variable, and it can increase or decrease, and it will gain or it will generate gain or it will generate pain, just harm or benefit. Suppose this one. This could be your salary. The higher the better, right? And below a certain point, there is really pain because you can't pay the rent anymore. Or the other way around, this could be the defects that you have to handle. The more defects you have to handle, the unhappier you get. But this is the linear stuff. The linear stuff is not interesting. The thing that is interesting is the non-linear stuff. And this is also from the book. Taleb says, anything that has more upside than downside from random events and shocks is anti-fragile. So something that likes shocks, something that likes random events, is actually anti-fragile. All the rest is fragile. And it's actually about the non-linear part of the system. So if something is accelerating towards harm or towards benefit, and you can see it in this graph, if you decrease this variable, it only generates a little extra gain. But if you increase the variable, it rushes, it accelerates towards pain. Other way around, if you increase this variable, there's only a little pain extra, but if you decrease the variable, it accelerates towards gain. What would this be? Would this be fragile or would this be anti-fragile? What do you think? This graph. Sorry?
Fragile.
It's fragile, yeah. Because this particular variable doesn't like random shocks, because whatever I do, increase or decrease, I always lose. I always generate pain. And this one is, of course, anti-fragile. I like shocks. Whatever shocks happen to the system, increase or decrease, it just generates gain. I always win. And but I don't know, of course, where I am. I could be at the blue dot, so I could. This is just theory. Just after that, I go into continuous deployment. I don't know whether I'm at the blue dot or I am at the yellow dot. So when I'm increasing or decreasing the variable, I don't know where I am. So I have to tinker. I have to try. And just to remember what is fragile and anti-fragile. just remember the frown and the smile. And the frown is, of course, fragile, and the smile is anti-fragile. Now, about continuous deployment. Suppose the variable is the number of deployments per month. And I don't deploy at all, because that's a very super stable back office system. And it's totally encapsulated. I don't have to change it at all. So I do not deploy at all. Well, then I'm happy. But as soon as I'm forced to do some deployments in that system, yeah, it slowly goes. I get unhappier and unhappier, and then I go towards pain. But if I keep increasing the number of deployments, yeah, I do it every week, I do it every day, then in the end I will get happy again. That's, of course, continuous deployment. So you could say continuous deployment is actually anti-fragile. But that's not for every company, because technical and organizational debt make you fragile. Who is familiar with technical debt? Ah, a lot of hands. And who is familiar with organizational debt? Yeah, the term is a little less famous, but actually you want to get rid of technical and organizational debt because they make you fragile. Because what you want to do, you want to apply the third way from the Phoenix Project, right? So you want to tinker, you want to trial and error, but you cannot do that if you are suffering from technical and organizational debt. And I think Gene Kim actually coined the best definition of technical debt. He said, it's what you feel the next time you want to make a change. All the quick and dirty things that I've been doing in the past and I didn't clean up afterwards, that's actually technical debt. But also, for instance, you have been investing in the meantime between failure all the time, because that was what your customer was asking for, and you didn't invest at least as many euros in the meantime to repair. So meantime to repair is also extremely important. I think maybe even more important than the meantime between failure. And the organizational debt is that the organization model does not fit your operational model, which means that the structure of your organization is not the structure of the process through the organization. And that's almost the case with all organizations, except for instance Netflix and Amazon, because they actually they completely turned over their organization to fit the operational model. Also, organizational debt is silos. Also, it's handoffs between teams, between silos, and also it's politics, fear, and ego. It's all examples of technical debt. Organizational debt. So what you want to do is you want to tinker in IT. You want to make trial and error. You want to do the third way, and that it's actually only possible if you are anti-fragile. Because when you're tinkering anti-fragile, then actually all the outliers will be positive. You will always gain. Just like in the remember the smile, the outliers are positive always. And for instance, look at this unicorn club. The unicorn club is the club of companies that are valued $1 billion or more. It gets busier and busier to the right. And actually, they are anti-fragile, because they started as a startup without technical debt and without organizational debt. If you are fragile and you are tinkering, remember the technical debt, remember the organizational debt, and you are tinkering, you can be sure that the outliers in the end will be negative. You will always lose. So you have to get rid of your organizational and technical debt first before you can tinker. So you want to actually decrease the technical debt and the organizational debt. So get rid of the red parts. And then you have a little problem, because you have to convince management of the fact that they should reserve time for solving technical and organizational debt. And then this four-color backlog comes along. Your organization, your customer, will only ask for the blue one and the yellow one. They only want functionality, they only want something that's on the product backlog, and of course they want their defects fixed. But there are two other colors, the technical debt, red, and the improvements, like for instance test automation. That's also something they that you should want, and that's also for the good of your company, of course, for your customer. The whole article is in the bottom of this slide. Producing milk or shoveling dirt. That's actually the title of the article. So if you ask your customer will say, okay, I just need blue and green because I want functionality added and I want my defect solved. But when you have six sprints, you see when you only mix these two colors, the defects increase and increase and increase, and you will have less and less blue to develop for your customer. So for your customer's own good, you should also add red and green. But you have to bite the bullet, of course, because if you add the red and the green in the fifth sprint, there will be no blue left, and we will actually have refactoring sprint, so to say. Another thing from the book is risk management. Actually, what Taleb says, risk management makes you fragile, because people who are doing risk management are actually only looking at what hurt them in the past. They are not looking in the future. So actually, you want to switch to the chaos monkey to take risks that allow you to learn. So big enough to learn, but not so big that it could ruin your company. So that's what the chaos monkey, of course, does. So just to make sure, who is familiar with the chaos monkey? A lot of hands. Okay, yeah. I will show it in two slides. But what Taleb actually says is risk management is actually risk theater. So it's actually not real. So when you get back in your company and, well, you should have a talk with your risk manager about what he is actually doing. Is he only looking, he or she, only looking to the past, what hurt him in the past, and not looking into the future? And in most cases, he will or she will answer positive. So what you want to do is you want to apply the chaos monkey. And the chaos monkey is actually the best example of anti-fragility in IT, because your system will get better from these little shocks of the chaos monkey. And of course, you may know that they also developed the latency monkey for introducing artificial latency, the janitor monkey, the conformity monkey, and Netflix. At one point in time, they even were forced to develop the chaos gorilla, because they got immune for the chaos monkey. It's open source, you can download it, and you can release it in your own production system. And everything is, of course, in a simian army, an army of monkeys. And that's the reason that also this position, a senior chaos engineer, is something that you can apply for. Yeah, serious business. Another thing from the book translated to IT is that software projects also make you fragile. In software projects, you are actually bringing people to the work, and in a stable DevOps team, you are bringing work to the people. The right part is stable and will stay stable for a long time, and a software project is of course temporary. And maybe you have heard of the hashtag no projects from Alan Kelly. He actually says building a tunnel or bridge with a temporary team, that's okay, no problem. But building software with a temporary team in a project, well, that's a really, really, really bad idea, because skin in the game is missing in projects. So the project does not have skin in the game of ops at all, actually. So he says what you are actually doing at the end of the project, you are destroying knowledge, you are destroying capabilities, and you are destroying performance. So actually, you should stop with projects, because projects are what they call fragilizers. And especially, as I already said, they have no skin in the ops game. They are balancing benefits and initial costs, and they are not looking at the operational costs, because otherwise maybe the project wouldn't even start, of course. So there's a reason for that also. If I use a graph for that. Again, the variable could be the number of tasks coordinated in a project. If I do not coordinate anything at all, then, well, there will be chaos, of course. But as soon as I start coordinating things, I will get happier and happier. But as you all know, software projects grow and grow and get more and more complex. And in the end, it rushes, it accelerates towards pain again. So you could say software projects are fragile. Another one from the book is about top-down management. Top-down management is also missing skin in the game of what is happening on the work floor. And literally, a quote from the book, it's easier to macro bullshit than to micro bullshit. So you can use bullshit high in the company, nobody notices, because they have no skin in the game with the work floor. And a bureaucracy is actually a means of preventing them from having skin in the game. So top management is also top-down management is also not a good idea. It's better to turn followers into leaders. And maybe you have heard of this particular Captain Marquet. Captain Marquet, he wrote a book, Turn the Ship Around, about actually pushing authority to the information level instead of pushing information to the authority level. What he means is, normally you gather information in an organization, you put it all the way down to the top of the organization, they take a decision, and then the decision goes downwards into the organization. What he actually says is, push that authority to the information level where it is. So you can cut a corner, and you can make your company faster. And of course, people at that level, they should be technically competent, they should have organizational clarity, and they should understand priorities, but it's a lot better to push that authority down to that level. So what you actually should do is decentralize decision making. And I borrowed this from Scaled Agile. They even say, okay, you can use this decision table. If a decision is infrequent and long lasting and it provides significant economies of scale, in that case, you should take a strategic decision. But when it is frequent, it's time critical, and it requires local information only, you should take the decision on a lower decentralized level. So you can just fill in the table with frequent, time critical, and economies of scale. And if it is lower than 4 or higher than 4, that's just an indication for to centralize or not centralize. I talked about anti-fragility, and until 2012, the word didn't even exist. Before 2012, we used other words like robust and resilient. And just to put it in perspective, I put in this particular slide that a fragile system is actually, that's the lower one, is actually deteriorating from the very beginning that it actually exists. A robust system, the blue one, will stay stable for a long time until it encounters a black swan. And the black swan is actually also a book from Taleb. A resilient system will break down a little temporary, but will then get back to the level it was. And anti-fragile, and think of the chaos monkey, will actually, from all the shocks that it encounters, it will get stronger and stronger. Just to give you some examples from outside IT and into IT, this one, this is of course fragile. This is also extremely fragile. And this is also fragile, as we already saw. So actually, Scrum alone, Agile alone, is, and Ken already stated that this very morning in his talk, that actually in the Agile Manifesto, they already in 2001 said that it was about continuous delivery, but we didn't have the tools to do continuous delivery. This is robust. This is also robust. You might recognize Unix. Does somebody see which bird this is? Yeah, the Phoenix. Yeah, the Phoenix. Phoenix is actually a very good example of resilience because it rises from the ashes of his predecessor. So it will not get better than his predecessor, but it will get at the same level as his predecessor. Also resilient is, for instance, an aircraft. Because if an electrical system fails, there's a backup electrical system. And if both electrical systems fail, there is a vacuum system or a hydraulic system. Or an aircraft is truly fail-safe, so it's resilient. And the best example of anti-fragility is actually this beast. Are you familiar with this one? Hydra, right. Hydra is actually, if you cut off a head of Hydra, it immediately grows back two heads. So from every attack, it gets stronger. So you could compare this also with a Chaos Monkey. How to become less fragile or even anti-fragile in IT? Well, then you have to build a system, an organization that gains from disorder. So we already touched continuous deployment, we already touched chaos engineering, but also, for instance, canary releases also in the same list, or A/B testing, or autoscaling. It's all examples of anti-fragility in software. And in the link at the bottom of the slide is a lot more. There are a lot more examples of anti-fragile software. Now, to conclude. You could say, is anti-fragility, is that a choice or is that a must? Well, I would say it's a must because your company has its time to market. It wants to speed up. Every organization wants to speed up. But at the same time, your organization also wants to be maneuverable. They continuously want to link the latest business opportunities with the latest technical developments. So you have to have speed and maneuverability. And speed is not what it used to be anymore because maybe you know this particular quote from Jeff Bezos. He says, we are actually shifting from 90% decisions to 70% decisions. You cannot wait anymore until you have 90% of the data to take the decision. You have to take the decision when you only have 70% of the data. And what he actually says is, being wrong may be less costly than you think, whereas being slow is going to be expensive for sure. That's the world we live in these days. And a perfect metaphor, of course, about fast and maneuverable is for instance, this F-22 Raptor. It can pull 15 Gs, but normally as a human being, you will lose your consciousness at 9G. And there's also a word for that, G-lock, G-force induced loss of consciousness. So actually you can compare this with a company. If you want speed, if you want maneuverability, you can train for that, but you cannot, you can train in a centrifuge, but you cannot cope with this very long. I've got a short video for you. This pilot is training to avoid G-lock, and he uses this training technique, and that means that he is actually contracting all his muscles in his arms, his legs, his stomach. So he is actually pressing the blood from his muscles back to his brain to stay conscious. And that's actually what he is doing. His heart rate is in the top left corner, in the top right corner. The G-force will go up to 9G. Normally you are unconscious then. And the lady who is talking to him, even yelling at him, is actually also talking about red and green lights, because the red and the green lights are at the side of his capsule, and when you are getting unconscious, there will be a tunnel vision, so you don't see what is here and what is there. So you are losing your sight on the red and the green lights, which are on the side of your vision. Just this 1.5 minute.
Is there any medical? Is ready, final ready, please. Activate your brake. Keep it squeezed unless you want to stop. 3, 2, 1, engage. Okay, and just like you've seen just about all afternoon, what I want you to do is stay nice, relaxed, good, head back against the headrest. You're going to wait until you lose all of your green lights or half of your red light. When that happens, you're going to take in a deep breath, bear down, and start the strainer maneuver. Good job. Just watch your red light. When you lose all the green, half the red, deep breath, start the strainer maneuver.
Centrifuge is already going like this.
When you lose all the green, half the red, deep breath, start the strainer maneuver. Lose all the green, half the red, deep breath, and start the strainer maneuver. Deep breath in through the mouth. Breathe. One, two, three. Breathe. Arms, legs, stomach. Breathe. One, two, three. Breathe. One, two, three. Breathe. Keep all the muscles tight. Breathe. One, two, three, breathe. Arms, legs, and stomach. Breathe. One, two, three, breathe. Work hard at it. Keep tight. Breathe. One, two, three, breathe. Arms, legs, stomach tight. Breathe. Coming down. Stay tight. Stay tight. Stay tight. Stay tight. Stay tight. Stay tight. Now you can relax. Relax. Totally relax. You are a G monster.
So, to avoid this, you have to become anti-fragile. Thank you. We don't have time for questions, I guess, or we do?
Well, we technically know, but one question, if it's short, then yes. Very short question.
Hi, so I know what Taleb thinks about this, but what are you, as a consultant, think about the concept of skin in the game in terms of consultancy? As a consultant, you're somebody who comes from outside the company. The decisions you encourage the company to do, you don't usually have skin in the game.
Yeah.
So how do you think about this?
Actually, the very concrete examples that I already showed, that's what I use. For instance, also the article that was in the bottom that shows a lot of examples. So you have to switch to anti-fragile thinking. That's actually you have to read the book, and it's very difficult because the book is there's a lot of math and a lot of formulas in the book. So you have to it's kind of a mind switch that you have to make before you can really apply anti-fragility. Yeah, and every situation is different, of course. Yeah, that answer your question? Well, I'm here all day and tomorrow, so just come by. Okay.
So thank you, Jan.
Thank you.